Thank you for coming, everyone. I'm really excited to share my thesis, Islas de Pasión, Haitian Afrofuturist Fiction, with you today. The question I want to... Haitian Afrofuturist Fiction. The question I want to foreground my presentation with is about interpretation. Who am I speaking for? Who am I speaking with? And I want to address factors that affect who's able to share their story, how far it reaches, and what listeners get from it. So my interest in storytelling called for community engagement as part of this thesis. Rather than looking at texts that were already written, I decided to work with writers to produce new ones. So, one possible interpretation of the Haitian Creole part of my title is, this is not a single story. This is a collaboration with 11 Haitian and Haitian American authors. I'm analyzing their texts, and our definition of Afrofuturism emerged from workshops and ongoing discussions with them. They've been a fantastic resource throughout this project. So, defining Afrofuturism. When I first started this project, I thought I was doing Haitian science fiction. I was vaguely aware of Afrofuturism, but I was wary of pigeonholing works as somehow separate from mainstream sci-fi. On my first trip to Haiti, when partners I approached expressed unfamiliarity with sci-fi as a term, I tried to explain what I was looking for by saying, I want stories that are anticipatory or artificial or alternative. And quickly, my alliterative scheme got into trouble because people started asking, well, why are you introducing this boundary between artificial and natural? And hey, what about supernatural? So when you say you're interested in the relationship between people and technology, why are you not including magic as its own sort of technology? So then I started saying, okay, I'm doing fantasy and sci-fi. But terms like fantasy and magic can mark something as unreal, especially when we're talking about belief systems that are already marginalized like voodoo. So we started using the Haitian Creole word mystique to convey respect for links between religious beliefs and real lived experiences. And those discussions in turn got me thinking about sci-fi too as a term. So when we call something a dystopia or utopia, you're sort of implying this hasn't happened yet. But actually, these scenarios are playing out to someone somewhere in the world, or they've happened before. So I noticed my participants were actually using things like, oh, that Hollywood movie reminded me of the earthquake, to interpret their own lived experiences. So really becoming more comfortable with Afrofuturism as a term that captures the particular perspective and the lived experiences these ideas are coming from. Things like Get Out coming out and having Jordan Peele say, no, this isn't horror, this is documentary. And things like Black Panther coming out and having Afrofuturism kind of enter popular discourse. It's still not really in circulation in Haiti, and a lot of my conversations with writers were about, are we comfortable introducing a new word to the lexicon? Are we comfortable with the idea that people will learn what Afrofuturism is by reading this collection? And we've increasingly did become confident about that, especially from reading works like Dark Matter by Cherie Renee Thomas, and even Edwige Dantica has a collection, Haitian Noir, so just this idea that you can define a genre by making a collection of it, and then you kind of go back and say, actually, this has existed for a while. There just wasn't a label for it before. So I really want to emphasize, I'm not making anything new. I am working to create new pieces, but this genre has existed in Haiti before I came around to name it. And so my research process also had this layer of traveling. I talk about going to the library, looking for books. I talk about the workshops that I went to in both Miami and Port-au-Prince. And I talk about attending the Ghetto Biennale in December. That's an international arts festival. You'll see some of the pieces we produced for that as part of the section headers for this different section. And I really want to use travel narratives in the thesis itself and in this presentation to talk about my own positionality. So my identities as a white American queer trans autistic linguist, I think all of those are influencing how I'm interpreting those works, and it's important to talk about them in my readings of the pieces. And finally, we've got this layer of secondary sources. So your standard scholarly lit review, but also I spent a lot of time looking at fiction. And I did that because I didn't want to pigeonhole these works as here's Haitian Afrofuturism. I wanted to connect them to Afrofuturism across the diaspora, which meant kind of getting a sense and a framework of what that was. So in my summer readings, I started taking notes on motifs that were cropping up repeatedly, and I kept returning to text. So I would transcribe my notes, I'd be translating the text, I'd be discussing it in a workshop. And through those turns, I got a better grasp on patterns and came up with this body, land, family framework to group them. The categories in this framework are by no means mutually exclusive. If I had to sum them up in a sentence, I'd say something like, where you come from matters, which obviously is not exclusive to Afrofuturist works. However, I found this to be a particularly useful lens for discussing members of diaspora, and it also combines my examinations of community, which are crucial to the meta discussion I want to have about storytelling and interpretation. So for the body section, for example, I'm looking at community membership in the sense of everyone is somebody. Stories here are about bodies that take multiple forms or are controlled by multiple forces. So unfortunately, I can't really do the stories justice today. I won't really be going too much into them, but we have a story about queer werewolves, my personal favorite. We have one about obsessed researchers and possessing zombies, child geniuses, and plastic beauty queens. And the personal experience that kind of framed this section for me was being in Haiti conducting workshops during the protests in Charlottesville, right on the anniversary of Bois Caïman. So Bois Caïman was the ceremony, it was both a voter ceremony and a war council that started the Haitian Revolution. And noticing the parallels between that and what was going on in Charlottesville, so Haitians fighting to end slavery and white supremacists and neo-Nazis fighting to arguing that it should have never ended here in the US. And I grew up in Charlottesville, so it was particularly poignant for me to be in Haiti while that was happening. And again, think about my own positionality in that. So again, this project is really about interpretation. The word I'm trying to interpret for the body section is moon. It literally translates to person, and we really get into questions of who counts as a member of the human community. So for me, looking at cannibalism in the literal sense of eating people, which does happen in the stories, but also in the sense of reducing someone to their economic function, to she's pretty so she can open a salon, he's smart so he can invent something, instead of their inherent value as a member of the community. They are one of us, they belong emotionally, no matter what they produce or contribute, which of course gets into questions of individual versus collective identity. And from a storytelling sense, really asking ourselves about questions of empathy. So for me, this idea of consuming narratives about oppression in which I am complicit, films like Get Out really made me start reflecting on the problems of not being able to relate to people until you can share their experiences by literally sharing their body. So are there ways of connecting to people and caring about people because we're able to construct a community in which we're all members, and in which we confront, again, oppressions in which we are complicit. So, also the land section was next, so this was framed with kind of a routes versus roots approach. One of the stories, which again, personal favorite, was Uber, but with witches. And we also have stories about trespassing in the spirit realm, about risky homecomings, in general, ideas about who gets to go, who's left behind, so mobility in both a social and a spatial sense. And the experience that framed this discussion was the gender dynamics of the event Ghetto Biennale that I attended. So looking at gender within the visiting artists and the local artist collective, and thinking about my own decisions to voice as, I use voice instead of come out, so to voice as queer or trans or not with people. And the concept I'm interested in interpreting here is crossroads, which is a really crucial idea within Vodou. So I'm looking at this question of hierarchy. Is it possible for people to meet on an equal footing given hierarchies and borders? And in a storytelling sense, who can tell their stories safely? How stories themselves can be a form of claiming power? So you might not be able to force someone down a path, but you can sort of move them with your narrative to take a particular direction. So this picture I've chosen is an intersection in Port-au-Prince where John Brown intersects with Martin Luther King. Again, just a really kind of poignant ways of influencing people thinking about that. And my last section, family, takes up this theme of children will listen. So we've got a divine birthday present, a love spell, a phone call of the devil himself, and a revolution set in 2155, the only story in our collection explicitly set in the future. And for this section, we're looking at kind of conflicts and intersections between innovation and tradition. So my frame for this section was the Haitian Creole language itself, which is still stigmatized in Haiti as too simple to convey complex concepts. So the idea that we're writing a book in this is still a kind of radical idea. And the word I chose for interpreting this section is sep, which you'll remember from my title, I translated as single, but it has another translation of simple. So here, instead of a simple versus revolutionary, I'm arguing that the simple can be revolutionary. In a storytelling sense, I'm pushing against narratives of exceptionalism, this idea that Creole languages or what happened in Haiti are somehow separate phenomena that don't really apply to us or can't really teach any of us because they're just so different and unique. The danger of marking something as special. It also gets into, so again, exceptional as opposed to everyday, and this idea of progress as opposed to a spiral. So if you're seeing history as a straight line, you can call Haiti a developing country, this idea that it's behind the US and one day we'll catch up. But looking for more nuanced perspectives that acknowledge the wealth of the US is based off of oppression. So it's not this time travel narrative where one country is behind and we'll catch up one day unless something really changes. And I thought this meme was pretty great because it's got, Haitians kind of use it to play with the idea of different Caribbean notions of on time, whereas foreigners take it and use it to kind of disparage Haitians and say, oh, my employees are always showing up late. So just how different people are even accessing this meme was really interesting to me. It definitely qualifies as an Afrofuturist meme. So as we go into the idea of spirals, I learned that some of the first people to use Haitian Creole in writing in Haiti called themselves spiralists. And their whole practice was based on rereading, rewriting, retelling. So those multiple layers of the word sep, it can mean single, it can mean simple, or it can mean magic, allow you to play with the language. And seeing that as a benefit instead of just counting the number of words in Haitian Creole and saying, oh, there aren't as many words here as French, therefore it can't convey complex ideas. And the idea of fractals being particularly fruitful, so taking a part and allowing it to stand for a larger whole. You see this is a very voodoo thing to do. So with Azali, the Loi of Love, the Loi are sort of like saints or gods. Tune in later for a more complex explanation of religion in Haiti. But Azali can take on three different aspects that I'm discussing in my thesis. So there's La Sirene, the wife, who's particularly relevant to the body section because she's got the half-animal form and she's known as a healer. There's Azali Freda, the lover, who is relevant to the land section because you can get into questions of female mobility and of ownership. And there's Danto, the mother, who's very relevant to the family section and to my thesis as a whole because her tongue was cut out during the revolution, so she has to rely on her child to interpret for her. But this idea that I was able to construct an arc for my thesis with these by focusing in on these different aspects of Azali. And once I realized I could do that, it dramatically improved the quality of my writing and the quality of my interpretation. Because I started to realize I can offer people fragments instead of giving the whole thing all at once. Instead of a perfect translation, asking my readers to accept, you're going to get a piece that stands in for the larger whole that's relevant here, but you're not going to get the whole thing. You have to be comfortable with having a fragment, with it not being perfect, with it being incomplete. So in my body section, I talk about zombie as reanimated slave corpses, the American brain-eating variety, not relevant here. Like I said, the Americans who are cannibals, it's not a Haitian thing. In the land section, I really was talking about metaphysical geography, so the idea of them as almost like angels in the sense that they are spirits of dead people who reside in their own separate realm was relevant. And then in the family section, I talk more about them as ghosts, the idea that they can return to the realm of the living and sort of haunt or convey information. And similarly with Lugawu, I really struggled with how to talk about Lugawu and their various manifestations across the stories until I realized, oh, with this body, land, family framework, I can divide up the aspects of the Lugawu. So with body, I can talk about them as shapeshifters. With the land, I can look at the gender, I can look at the idea of settling down with a man, settling down with children, and decide, okay, people who don't do that are stigmatized as witches. And in the vampire section, I can introduce the intergenerational aspect of that. So this idea that elders are staying young by sucking on life force. Of course, there's always aspects that, even in this fractal mode of theorizing, there are just no parallels and they don't translate. So for example, both the zombie and the Lugawu have an interesting interaction with salt. You can use salt to cure a zombie, and you can use it to ward off a Lugawu, because Lugawu shed their skin. So if you rub salt in the skin that they leave behind, they will not be able to put it back on and they will die. So this idea of monsters can be defeated, zombie can be healed, kind of plays into something I saw in the stories themselves, that there is not always a resolved ending. So again, going back to the idea of a spiral and being comfortable with fragments, being comfortable with just getting pieces. A lot of the writers, we had this long discussion about, is it okay to not have a definitive ending to your story? People were worried about that. And some researchers I was looking at noted that it's a particularly feminist sci-fi practice to have these ambiguous endings. And we kind of talked about how it's almost a challenge to the reader. If you want to see the end, if you want to see a better world, you have to work to fulfill that. We're not going to guarantee it through the story itself. So you can have, we have this promise of salt, but it's an unfulfilled promise. And that's definitely a very provocative thing, and I would argue that's also an Afrofuturist feature of these stories. I just want to conclude with thank yous. As I mentioned, there's 11 authors who participated. I'm not going to put their names due to research anonymity things, but when the book comes out, you can find out who wrote what. I'd like to thank Kara Thompson for serving as advisor on this project. Thank you, committee members, for attending and reading and serving as guides and support through the process as well. And Michelle DeGraff helped with recruiting offers and is just really inspirational as a Haitian linguist. MJ Fiev helped set up the Miami Book Fair event, and was also wonderful with helping to recruit people, at which Dantuka put me in touch with her. And the Haitian Studies Association in November gave me kind of a space to interact with people and rehearse a preliminary version of this, very preliminary version of this presentation. So thank you to everyone, Messi. Thanks, friends, for coming. And yeah, that is Haitian Afrofuturism, a small fractal segment of it.